So John Peck.
Just in time, John.
Hack man arrives on time.
I try to, sir. During your all's break, I put a very brief handout up next to you. I don't think I'm going to tell you a whole lot more than what we have already known previously, but I'll review it very quickly. Bottom line is we need an H designation in order to haul patients, get paid for it, and also to consider a facility that replaces the current Pungo Biden facility, or Biden Pungo, I'm sorry. It's going to require the H designator. Without that, we're not going to be able to get reimbursed for taking patients there. It doesn't mean we won't take patients there if it's going to extend their life or we have a good chance to save their life. But the information that I have received will require Dr. Penley, our medical director, to sit down and write new protocols. Protocols that help the EMT make that decision. Do they stop at that clinic? And it could have something to do if the clinic is a 24-hour clinic, but there is a nurse on duty and not a doctor. We don't need to be waiting 30 minutes for the doctor to get there. We need to go keep on going on what we're doing and get them to the hospital as soon as we can. So there's all kinds of ifs, ands, and buts there. If it's a specialty clinic, what are their specialties? What capabilities do they have? And as Dr. Penley's role is, as you all pointed her, as the medical director for EMS, to sit down and go through those and make sure we're not violating any of the state's protocols that we've adopted in the way of treatment to the patients. But regardless of whether we're paid or not, if there's a capability there to save somebody's life, we're going to stop there first and then do whatever we need to do. The bottom line, some people seem to think when I'm talking that I'm only worried about money, but money is money, but lives are more important than any dollar we'll ever put on it. When we first started talking about this, I got a temporary increase estimate from our current provider at White Oak EMS. Well, it's White Oak Medical Transport, but I treat them just like they're one of our own. So they've provided a very good service. The temporary increase equated to $250,000 a year as a temporary measure. We thought we were looking at 4 to 5 months, not 18 months or whatever, between when the emergency room was going to open and or close, and then something that would be similar to that open. But then we don't know that that's exactly what's going to happen. But $250,000 would be a short-term incremental, however many months it is, you can divide to $250,000. The reason for the additional cost being so high is very simple. They're not going to have any more ridership than what they currently have. There's no way for the vendor to be able to recover any of his cost. What we're doing is covering for that long lag time between when he picks a patient up and brings them Viden Beaufort, as opposed to taking them, in most cases, 7 or 8 minutes to Viden Pungo. It's a much longer turnaround, and that would leave that whole area without an ambulance, without any other form of emergency care. And then I want to point out once again, though, that we answer every call to 911 as if it's an emergency. We have no other choice. That is the protocol. So any EMS call, anybody calls 911, they're going to get a lights and siren screaming ambulance to their house because that's what it says we have to do. Volunteer squads, everybody thinks they're not going to be impacted. But when you start talking about the wear and tear on their vehicles, the fuel cost, what used to be Pamlico Beach taking out of Pamlico Beach and going up to Viden Pungo and being back to Pamlico Beach, a 47 minutes to 60 minutes is now going to be increased at least by another half hour, maybe even longer. And that is wear and tear on the equipment, additional fuel costs. Remember, these ambulances, if we're lucky, they get 4 miles to the gallon, if we're lucky. So there is going to be additional cost there. There's also additional wear and tear on the families and the loved ones of volunteers, and people sometimes don't remember. When you take off, you're going to be gone 2 hours or more, and it can impact your employer. People that are anywhere close to time that they're supposed to be going to work are not going to answer that call because they're worried about missing work. Bottom line, we're going to have to renegotiate the contract with White Oak Medical Transport. The actual annual cost, I would estimate at this point, it's going to be $300,000 a year increase, because when he was telling me the 250, he didn't count on all the extra fuel. He didn't count on the wear and tear on his equipment. And that's significant, because we contracted him to pick people up in the Pantego Township and take them to Bellhaven. Occasionally, he was going to have to take people to Beaufort, but that was an occasional situation. So when you look at it and sit down, that's $300,000 plus the already $70,500 that we take out of the current general revenue in order to pay the bills, our portion of the 75% to the Pantego Bellhaven EMS Incorporated. That's going to have to come out of our general fund, because we're already maxed out on the EMS fee that we currently charge the residents of the Pantego Township. And it should require an increase in the EMS tax for the Bath Township. I'm still working on what it's going to be. I'm trying to figure out what the fuel use and all these things are. But at their current reimbursement rates, neither of the two volunteer squads charge anything. And since they don't charge anything for their services, the only other recourse, if we don't push them to start charging, is to do an EMS tax increase. And that's the bottom line. $300,000 plus, if they don't put an H-designated facility in, plus an increase for the Bath Township and the amount of EMS tax money they're receiving. And I'm not going to try to guess at that. You all expect me to bring you facts, and I'm working as hard as I can to figure it out.
Questions from commissioners?
I have one.
Go ahead.
I suppose we should pray for the H designation. Then, of course, we could take them to Pungo, Biden, and not have to worry about moving them over to Beaufort. And, of course, Pungo, Biden be the fallback position if they absolutely have to go somewhere quick. Then again, you've got to, you know, figure, are they going to be able to help them at Pungo Vine? Because they're going to have so many limitations.
Yes, sir, they are.
The way they're planning it now, of course, that could change at some point.
Yes, sir.
Let me ask you, since we're talking about the praying for the H designation, what would they have to do differently, in your opinion, to get the H designation at Pungo Vine?
They're going to have to apply and hope that the federal government will grant them to continue the Critical Access Hospital CAH designation, which is, it just depends on who gets the grant paperwork, who gets the paperwork, and who approves it and who doesn't. They're not approving very many of those, but because it's a legacy, they may very well be able to get that through. But they're going to have to build a facility. If I'm reading the current federal regulations correctly, they're going to have to build a facility that's a 25-bed, because they've got to be able to guarantee that 15 beds at a minimum are going to have 90% occupancy for at least 3 days.
And they're not going to do that.
Which they don't have now.
Yes, sir. But I'm trying to answer directly the question on what they would have to do. Plus, it's got to have a fully functional emergency room. And that is one of the most expensive parts of a hospital there is. And I go on fact and what I've been told, and I'm proceeding to do what we've got to do to try to make sure we have two intermediate level ambulances on duty up there when that hospital, when that emergency room closes, because I can guarantee you, if we have one intermediate, one basic, intermediate goes out on what they think is a heart, a stroke, a burn, or another situation, and they're in the middle of transport when the real heart attack gets, we get the call. And then we have the basics, and they'll do all they can do. But there are limitations to what a basic can do as opposed to an intermediate.
Mr. Chairman,
I got Mr. Booth.
But the fact this $300,000 increase, is that just for the Bellhaven, or is it just for the eastern end of the county?
That is just for, that would be going to the Bellhaven Pantego Township Incorporated to meet our part of the obligation of 75% to just furnish Pantego Township.
So that still, that $300,000 does not include the Bath Township?
No, sir.
Okay. Now, it's, we understand that it's needed, and you got to have the two ambulance services probably all the time now. But do anybody have any data right now how many times a week that White Oak come to Boca County or White Oak go to Pungo District?
Sir, 99% of all the calls, when I looked it up, White Oak goes to Vidin-Pungo.
And how many was that 99%?
That was 416, and there were four times when they came to Beaufort.
Wow.
So And all those calls will have to, probably if they don't get the H designation, they'll have to...
They're going to have to come down here to this hospital, and that's what Dr. Penley is trying to get the emergency room prepared for.
Well, what you need to think in terms of with the subsidies that we now put into some of these districts and the taxes that we collect, which is up to 5 cents, is all that we can collect for emergency services in these districts. If they don't get the H designation, then Beaufort County is going to need to sit down and take a look at policy for the whole system, because just throwing money to the eastern part of the county doesn't solve a lot of problems a lot of other places. And with that is going to be a combination, I think, of volunteers, hired help, and a billing system that we can collect for making these runs in order to make this whole thing work. Central billing system, perhaps. But at any rate, I think we're going to need to sit down once we find out what Vidant is really going to do. And we're going to have to look at the whole system and see what we can work out that saves us the most money and provides the best service.
A comment. I sent you that document in relation to the Department of Health and Human Services.
Yes, sir.
U.S. Department. And apparently with Obamacare coming on board, one of the things they're looking at is reducing Medicare costs wherever possible. And the reason that report was done in critical access hospitals was to see how much they could save if they were to able to eliminate about 75% of the critical access hospitals. And they had actual numbers that they put on as far as the savings were concerned for those hospitals. Basically, as long as that's a hospital, where it's at right now, we're fine. But the minute we put up a new building, the chances of it ever being declared a critical access hospital are negligent, because it would not meet the federal guidelines of what the document says at this point in time, which is a shame. I would hope that they could get a H designation. I would think that they ought to come up with something on the federal level or whatever. That sort of designation could be given to emergency room facilities, so that that could be a way that rural communities could move people in relation to emergency care. Because if they go with their definitions now, all they're going to do is reduce the costs of Medicare, supposedly, but not really, because people are going to die and possibly get sicker because of not being able to get transported properly. And it's just going to be a huge monetary mess. One of the things I'm very concerned about, and I'll ask you a question about it, is I'm very concerned about the level of service that we would need to provide. Presently, we have level 2 service that comes out of Belhaven. We got level 2 service that comes out of Broad Creek. We have level 2 service that comes out of the city of Washington. And we got level 2 service that comes out of Chocowinity, as far as I know. I'll be very much concerned about not having a higher level of care coming out of both Belhaven. And I also am very concerned about it coming out of Aurora also, because in relation to Aurora, often you may have Chocowinity going all the way down there to pick up people and drag them here. Well, what's your opinion on what level of care we need to provide in relation to these long-duration trips?
Within 30 days, the Aurora squad will be at an intermediate level.
Level 2.
They have completed all the requirements necessary, and the documents have been signed, and it will be forwarded tomorrow morning to State OEMS, who has already indicated they'll approve it. All they have to do is go down and check those out. Now, as far as paramedic level services, which is what you're referring to,
level
sir,
3.
I think that would be something we would need to look to, as Commissioner Richardson said, at the overall entire system. Because as it stands right now, we are not supposed to be running a 3-level system. You can run a 2-level system. You can run paramedics and intermediates, but you're not supposed to run paramedics, intermediates, and basics, all 3 at the same time. That doesn't mean State NCOEMS wouldn't approve it. I'm just saying they try to keep people from doing that, as far as all the squads will either be paramedic or intermediate or some combination thereof. But, sir, that's something that takes a while to put in place. It takes a lot of training to be paramedics. Mm-hmm. Right now in our current system, we have 7 paramedics who run at our intermediate level on some of our ambulances in the entire county. That's all that have a registered residency here in Beaufort County. That is one thing I can run through the CIS system of North Carolina Emergency Medical Services, and I run those reports to try to get an idea. Because anything we want to do in the future, we've got to have some idea of where it's all coming and how we're going to get there.
Okay. What level of service comes out of Hyde County, do you know?
They run paramedics, sir. And they have normally one crew on duty for the inland, and they have an on-call paramedic staff out on Ocracoke. But they're going to have to go to 2 crews in Hyde County, and their figures are even more expensive than the ones I just gave you.
Thank you.
But the future, yes, sir, we'll see. We'll see what comes out of this. That'll help us look to the future.
Right now, is it?
Sir, I always have hope, no matter what. Okay. I always have hope a hurricane's going to go somewhere else.
God bless you.
But I got to be prepared.
Got to be prepared.
Anything further from any of the commissioners? Thank you, Mr. Pack.
Yes, sir.
Commissioner Richardson.